Hi guys, Nick Jennison from Guitar Interactive and GI Plus. Happy New Year, it is 2023. Welcome to our first stream of the year. It's a pleasure to be here. Thank you so much for joining us. If you're wondering why I sound a little bit unusual, it's not because we're trying anything different with the audio, although we are trying some different stuff with video. I'll tell you guys about that in a minute. It's because I have finally succumbed to the illness that is going around. It's not the illness, it's an illness. So I've got a bit of a cold, feeling a little bit sorry for myself, but you guys being on this stream with me is cheering me up no end. So hey, listen, thank you so much for joining us. I want to take this opportunity to wish you a really, really happy new year and all the best for 2023. We're looking forward to producing some really, really great streams for you guys. Of course, I say that with some hesitation in my voice because we don't really produce the streams for you guys. We produce the streams with you guys because we couldn't do it without you. So thank you so much for tuning in. If you're a first time viewer, hey, it's great to see you. If you're watching this on the replay, that's cool too. We've got some really, really great stuff for you. So today we're going to be discussing primarily how you can become the best version of yourself as a guitar player in 2023. So we're kind of taking a little bit of a deviation from our artist focus streams just for this week. Now we will get back onto the artist specific stuff because you guys seem to love that sort of stuff. So if there's artists you want us to take a look at, let us know in the comments. We'd love to hear from you. We'll be getting back onto that over the course of the next few weeks. Sorry, and if I keep stopping, by the way, at any point, if I keep stopping my flow of thoughts and doing something like this, it's because I keep having to cough because I've got a bit of a tickly throat or I may have to sneeze. But that's okay. I would not miss the stream for the world. And of course, I can't infect you guys over video. So listen, couple of things, bit of housekeeping before we go. If you are enjoying the streams that we're putting out as much as we are making them, then a few ways you can help us keep the lights on. You can go to this URL down here, guitarinteractivemagazine.com/GI-plus. That is GI hyphen the word plus, P-L-U-S. Where you can go and get more guitar lessons like this and the courses we'll be talking about over the course of this stream. So we've got loads of GI Plus members in the chat. You guys seem to be really getting some great use out of the lessons we've made now, and we have so many more of them coming in the new year. Now, as a Christmas present for you guys, I rushed the release of Picking Strategies Part 1. That's available now on your GI Plus membership. If any of you have been practicing your picking over Christmas, then hey, I'd love to hear from you. Anyway, let's check in with the stream. Let's see how you guys are getting on. Ooh, sorry, before I go on any further, a couple of other things too. Other ways you can help us if you are maybe a little strapped for cash because, hey, it's been Christmas and New Year. A couple of ways you can help us for free is you can share this stream with your guitar playing friends. We'd like to get this out to as many guitar players as we possibly can. You can give us a thumbs up on the video. It helps more than you could possibly imagine. And of course, you can give us a comment. You can engage in our blossoming community of guitar players in the chat. The chat is my favorite part of this stream, right? I love playing for you guys. I love talking for you guys. I love talking and playing full stop, but the chat is my absolute favorite part of these streams. So we'd love to hear from you. We'd love to hear what your goals are for 2023, what you've been up to over Christmas. But for the time being, let's just check in with the chat and see how everyone's getting on. So we got Marcine first through the door. Marcine, I think, was probably here last year because he's always the first through. Says, hi guys, hello Nick, happy new year. Let's start with a fantastic stream. I will try my best. But of course, it's always a fantastic stream when you guys are here because it's always great with your comments and with your questions. We love a bit of that. By the way, if you have questions, drop them in the comments. We'll be answering those as usual towards the end of our hour together. So who else do we have? Sacred God Slayer is in the house. Says, hi Marcine, hi Nick, hi guys. I wish you all a happy new year. And you, my man, to everybody who's wished us a happy new year. I'm just going to do this all at once. Happy new year to you all. Thank you so much for joining us. Looking forward to a great year playing guitar together. Marcine is back in the house. PJ is in the stream, says, hi Marcine, SGS and Nick, and all wishing you the best for 2023. You too, my man, appreciate it, very, very kind. We have a question from GIHQ saying, happy new year everyone, hope Santa was good to you all, custom shop guitars all around, right? I wish, could you imagine? Honestly, I've stopped buying guitars, it's terrible. I should buy more guitars. I feel like a bad guitar player because I'm not buying instruments, but I've been buying camera gear instead. So I've got a lovely new lens on the go, which doesn't appear to have made a whole lot of difference on the stream. I think that's just YouTube crushing the stream quality, but it's no big. So we've got a lovely new lens. If it looks any better, hey, let me know. You'll make my day. Who else do we have? Larry Warren is in the house. Marcin has been practicing so much that everybody forgot he existed. So no custom shop acts for me. Santa will mark you down as a good boy for next year, Marcin, because you've been practicing so much. That's good. Thomas Smith Jr., on the other hand, got a new Kramer Beretta special. Very cool. Very underrated guitars, the old Kramers. I've got a friend of mine, Ian, who absolutely adores Kramers. So I'm going to set one of his up for him quite soon. But they're just killer instruments, right? Absolutely wicked. Went through a strange period when they were originally acquired by Gibson, maybe in the, I want to say, early 2000s. I don't think my timeline's quite right there, but under the Music Yo thing. Still great guitars, but really, really affordable, with some absolutely hilarious marketing blurb. You've no idea. Like, if you haven't seen the website, oh, it's worth going on the Wayback Machine just to take a look. Frank is in the house. Gordon Bennett is in the house. Says, hi, all. Hope you had a great 20... Hope you all have a great 2023. You too, Gordon. Thank you so much for joining us. David Reese is in here. Our friend Panu from Switzerland is in the house. Steve McDee is here. David Yates, my meathead friend. I don't even know if David Yates is a meathead, but I keep calling him Dorian Yates because I'm a meathead. So there you go. Kim, the big boss in the house, just been on the phone to Kim. Kim is fighting. Finally, Kim's the hardest worker in the room, and he's finally taken a little bit of time off, so we'll see how long that lasts. Keith MOF, he's in the house, says, hi, happy new year all. Blue Sumlin is in the house. Thomas Smith, David Peterson, St. Regodslayer got a GI Plus subscription for Christmas. I'm going to suggest if you've got a little bit of Christmas money kicking around and you want to improve your guitar playing game, the GI Plus subscription is probably the best way to do it, I think. We'll tell you more about that as we go on. Mark McNish is in the house. Darren Wall is in the house. Oh, I've got to go back to this comment very quickly, by the way. The Mick Goodrick book is absolutely excellent. If you guys haven't checked that out, just Google Mick Goodrick guitar book after this stream, of course, and you'll find some gold. My friend Darren from round the corner is tuning in. Darren, it's great to see you. I feel like I haven't heard from you in ages, man, but hey, it's great to have you live on the stream. Hope you're doing really, really well. Dazed Confused is in. All the best for 2023, Nick and the team. You too, my man. David Yates had the flu too. Oh no, still recovering. It was... we can't swear this early in the stream or the algorithm will crush us. But yes, that. Dude, I 100% agree, right? This is like my fourth day. I had a gig on New Year's Eve and I've started to feel pretty ill for that. And it was a long, long, long show and I really wanted to cancel it. But it's a great little venue and I love the band I play with. So I didn't want to call it. I didn't want to be that guy who's like, oh no, I'm ill, I can't do the gig. But let me tell you, singing for 3+ hours, whew, that was not fun. And then I crashed really hard yesterday. But I'm feeling a bit better today, just in time for the stream. St. Regodslayer is very happy to have seen you in an Andertons vid, by the way. Yeah, the Andertons vid was a lot of fun. We've got a few more coming out. I won't spoil them. But that was a whole lot of fun. The Andertons guys are good people. They're a really nice bunch. What you see on camera is what you get. So you meet like a few people who are maybe have a persona on camera. I don't think that's me. I think I'm just the same on camera as I am in the flesh. I don't know. But the Andertons guys are like that. And I can really respect that because they come across as really great guys on camera. And that's who they are. Lovely, very, very welcoming team. Great setup they got down there too. So yeah, you'll see hopefully some more from me on that channel over the next couple of months. That'll be really cool. Mark McNish is in the house. My new Sunburst Rev Star is finally on its way. Thursday delivery. It'll sit and warm up and then it's playtime. That's smart. You know, if you have a lovely finish on a guitar, it's sometimes wise if it's been in transit, especially if it's come from a foreign country, to let it sit for a day and acclimate before you open it. Otherwise, you can get finish checking. Although Rev Stars look pretty cool when they're worn, so maybe finish checking might be nice. Don't do that, my recommendation. But I think that's a smart idea. Really, really smart idea. Who else do we have? I think a new commenter, Aris. Hey man, it is great to have you. Happy New Year, keep on rocking. Hey man, if this is your first time commenting, thank you so much for taking the time to join us. Really, really appreciate it. Keena Page has been notably absent from our streams recently, but hey man, it's great to have you back on board. It's good to see you, man. You had some great questions last time we spoke, so looking forward to some more of those today. Happy New Year to you too. Who else do we have? Oh yeah, if you want some more lessons, this is the link. Go get it done. My friend Scott is in the house. Scott's been sending me some videos and playing some Mammoth tracks, some Wolf Van Halen Mammoth. And it sounds killer on a Line 6 Catalyst, no less, which is a bit of a sleeper amp. I like the old Catalyst. They get a bit of flack, but I think they're killer. Rick says, lens looks brilliant. Hey, man, thank you so much. Appreciate that. It is a Sigma 1.4 16mm, which I gather makes me a YouTuber now, because that's the lens everybody has. Who knows? Shout out the picture. It says Blue Sumlin. Hey, that's pretty cool, man. I like that. Klaus Peterson says, where does people reach you? You can find me on Instagram. If you go to Instagram and search for at Nick Jennison, you can reach me on there. Send me a message if you want to chat. We'll talk about guitar. Don Goller is in the house. You're even more handsome with the new lens. Check is in the post. Thank you so much. Dave Ram is in the house. Hey, man, it's good to see you. How are you doing? Lars is in the house. Got the itchy cough too. No gigging. No good for gigging, Lars. You are telling me. Hey, it's great to hear from you, man. I hope you're doing well. Lovely to see you, my man. Lars is a great egg. Who else do we have? We've got a couple more comments real quick. We'll just get in here real quickly. Pablo, I'll say it again. Pablo Cesar. JD, there's Merry Christmas to everybody from Veracruz, Mexico. I wish I was there because it's pretty cold here, and I gather it's probably nice and warm in Mexico. And I love Mexican food, like actual Mexican food, not Tex-Mex food. But I love Tex-Mex food too. So anyway, who else do we have? Don Goller is just surfacing after COVID over Christmas. Bad timing, but on the road to recovery, hopefully. That was me last year. You guys remember I missed our Christmas stream last year because I was in bed with the Rona. Sucks, but never mind. It was one of those two. Who else do we have? Sarah Godslayer says Lee was able to handle Satchel, so he must be a great guy. He's a great interviewer, you know. He's just a real good dude. Very welcoming, asks a lot of great questions. I think I just talked more than, I think I must have the award for most talkative guest, but hey, whatever. What are you going to do? You know, I'm not about to be any different, I guess, but you know, hey, who knows? But no, it was great fun. They were a really, really good bunch. Anyway, listen, we're going to get onto the meat of today's stream, which is setting goals for 2023 to help you improve as a guitar player. But before we do that, just want to take a quick moment to show you this in case you missed it. There's only been one stream since this has launched, because obviously we took Boxing Day off because I was full of turkey. I wasn't full of cold at that point, but I was full of turkey. I want to take this opportunity to show you our latest course on GI Plus. This is Picking Strategies Part 1. So if you want to improve your picking game, you should go to the URL down below and check this out. And when we come back, we'll be talking about goals. So what I want to know from you guys in the comments, drop your comments down below for what your guitar playing goals are in 2023. But in the meantime, this is Picking Strategies Part 1.
Does your picking feel uncoordinated and sometimes you miss notes or fluff transitions from string to string, maybe a little bit like this? When in reality what you want is smooth and easy and transparent feeling picking, a bit like this. Or maybe you've been sold on the idea that there's one specific way that you have to pick on the guitar and everything else is wrong, but that particular cookie cutter approach just doesn't work for you. It feels unnatural. It almost feels like you're fighting your own body to try and make it work. Well, Picking Strategies Part 1 is the course for you. In this course, we explore the many different ways that you can form a full and complete and comprehensive picking approach by examining the various strategies used by some of the greatest pickers of all time. And there are a whole bunch of strategies out there, and I guarantee there is one that is going to work for your preferred picking mechanics, the way you prefer to stand or sit with the guitar, the type of guitar you play, the type of music you play. There is a strategy for you. We're going to explore all of them, and I'm going to show you how you can take a single solo study and play every line within it using all of the six picking strategies that we look at in this course. And of course, This entire course is available as part of your GI Plus membership. So if you're not signed up already, what better excuse do you need to sign up today?
So that's a look at Picking Strategies Part 1 that's available as part of your GI Plus subscription. Guys, I had so much fun putting that course together, but there was a lot of work went into it, let me tell you. So really proud that we can bring it to you. I think you guys are going to get some great use out of it. Our friend PJ is already telling us how much fun he's having with it. Picking Strategies is really good. I found out that I am an oddity. Well, you know, dude, in some way, aren't we all? Told you I have to keep doing that when I'm coughing, but I don't want to cough down the mic at you guys. So, in some degree, we're all kind of picking oddities because there's not really one kind of like one size fits all picking approach, which is what the whole course is about. So it's not about like, this is the only way to do it. So if you're looking to be like kind of taken by the hand and shown, hey, this is the way you must pick, it's kind of not it. But instead, what we do is we kind of guide you through the process of discovering a way of developing a full and complete picking approach. But we do then take you by the hand to show you how that all works. So it's pretty comprehensive, it's pretty deep, and there's a cool solo study there too. And I'm actually playing the same guitar that I played in that course, which is nice. This guitar absolutely effing rips, by the way. This is my first PRS. It's custom 22 and it is gorgeous. The only guitar I have left of my own guitars that don't have Fishman Fluences in, because these pickups are magic and I won't change them. But I couldn't get another set made because we don't know what they are. Anyway, so let's crack on. So we've got some goals have come through now. This is interesting because what a lot of you guys have said is that your goals are quite lofty and it's like, oh no, lofty goals. You may have heard some people talk about this idea of smart goals before. I'm going to backtrack on this because I actually said in our previous goal setting stream this time last year, smart goals are a good idea. I'm actually going to kind of backtrack on that because there's been some research that has come to my attention lately that is kind of flying in the face of that. And I'm going to share some ideas on goal setting with you guys as we go. But let's take a look at what you guys are into. So Keenan Page says, yes, that's the course I've been trying to get. Thanks, man. I appreciate it. I think you're going to really enjoy it. My goal is to master speed picking and alternate picking. Well, dude, that is the course for you for sure. Saint Regards Layer says, it's a high goal, but I've discovered Ted Green through his Baroque videos, so I'll be trying to work on those ideas. That is very, very cool. Very nice. Steve McD, 2023, I want to improve my technique, especially string muting. Marcine says, I still have not gotten that melodic minor scale, maybe this year. That's a good shout. Yes, this year. My goal is to this is a very good one. My goal is to work out how to use a DAW and record some music. That is pretty cool. I like that. Excuse me a moment. Yeah, I'm going to keep having to do this because I'm just coughing up a lung here. But don't worry, I'm not going to let that put me off. It may put you guys off. So if there are any awkward silences where I do this, that's because I'm coughing, because I'm ill. Anyway, who else do we have? Blue Summon has got an interesting one here. Says, the problem with New Year resolutions is keeping them. I'm going to talk to you guys about that in a second. Let's start that up, because there's some interesting research that's been drawn to my attention about this. And I'll tell you where it's all coming from, because these are not ideas that I've made up. I can't take any credit for them, but at the same time, that should hopefully give you a degree of confidence in what I'm about to say, because I haven't just pulled this out of my proverbial rear end, let's say. Don Goller has another one, says, not sure if I have the coordination to get anywhere near that, though something we'll look into. Now, I will say that you can get huge gains. I'm guessing he's talking about picking strategies. You can get huge, huge gains from practicing this stuff and never come anywhere close to that sort of mega shred speed and still have like massive results. It can have a massive impact on your playing. A lot of guys that you think of who are like very fast players won't play at that kind of like ultra shred kind of pace, if that makes any sense. So for example, Eric Johnson, we always think of Eric Johnson as an incredibly fast and fluid player, because he is, but never quite touches on that sort of like next gear kind of like ultra shred sort of thing. I don't think that's something most people will necessarily want nor need nor necessarily achieve, but it doesn't matter because the principles are still the same and you can still get cleaner and more accurate with your picking with the stuff that we talk about in that course. So yeah, man, it's still worth looking into. Who else do we have? Miguel, so good, he said it twice, says can't increase his speed. We have another one here as well, which is, pardon me, which is from Senju, I don't know how to pronounce that, Senju Yuzu, I don't know. I'm just going to call you Senju because I butcher everybody's usernames, which is my fault, very much. Hey everyone, my goal on the guitar is to improve my picking precision and left-hand coordination. These are good goals. Right, so let's talk a little bit about New Year's resolutions and whether or not folks keep them, because there's an interesting thing where there's been some longitudinal studies on this where people will, or the researchers will, take a group of folks and keep in touch with them after they've made their New Year's resolutions. And it seems like at the 6 month mark, somewhere in the region of about 60% of the folks that they kept in touch with have actually managed to successfully keep their New Year's resolution within 6 months. And 6 months is enough time to make something part of your life. It's enough time to make something a habit. If you ever read like Atomic Habits, for example, that's that talks about all that stuff, but that's another story for another day. So New Year's resolutions, I don't think they're as bad as everybody gives them, as everybody wants you to believe they are, I suppose. That's maybe not the right words, but you know, maybe people kind of dunk on New Year's resolutions in a way that maybe we shouldn't. So, coughing again. So what we might think about this, there's an important part of goal setting that's called temporal landmarks. So temporal landmarks are where you find a time that marks the transition from old you to new you. And this is actually really legit. So it can be the start of a month, it can be the start of a week, it can be the start of... do you know, like, if we start of a new year is a very, very obvious one where it's like, okay, we are going to start the new year with a new me. So if you have productivity goals, for example, a new year is a very good time to do it, because let's be honest, nobody's being productive between Christmas and New Year. It's just not happening, right? And if you want to be, nobody else wants to be productive with you, and no person is an island in this regard. So that's a good example of why New Year. Also, fitness goals. You know, let's be honest, you're going to eat like a crazy person over Christmas and New Year. Of course you are. So maybe it's not the time to start a new fitness goal in the middle of December. You know, yeah, maybe that's not the thing. I want to quickly answer this, by the way. Keenan Page says, can you drop your Instagram name so I can reach out to you? I need to get this picking course and don't know how to get the membership. The thing to do, my man, is to... reach out to us if you want the tech support side of things. Reach out to us at Guitar Interactive Magazine, if that makes sense. So anyway, nobody's productive except Kim Waller. Kim is constantly productive. That's why Kim's the big boss, man. Anyway, so pardon me. So setting goals at New Year can actually be a very, very useful thing. And it also gives you a time frame to measure your goals, because you can measure your goals from year to year. So you can sort of go, how far have I gotten since this temporal landmark last year? And what do I need to do to get better results this year? So I don't think there's anything wrong with that. Now, an interesting thing about SMART goals that was brought to my attention with this. So we talked about SMART goals before. SMART goals are that SMA, pardon me, that SMART, coughing again, acronym that we often use to set goals. They're quite interesting because apparently they've actually come from management practice. So they're very good in the office, but not necessarily that great for your personal creative goals. So instead, I'm going to encourage you to take a look at something that comes from a new body of research that I've become aware of. Now, I will say I got this from the Stronger by Science podcast, and most of the ideas I'm going to talk about in this next little section are going to be related to that. So if you want to go and check that out, it's episode 71 of the Stronger by Science podcast, and that's all to do with fitness and health, but there are conclusions you can draw from what they're saying about guitar playing, and hopefully I can interpret that for you guys a little bit. So I want to show you this. This is an example of a hierarchy of goals. So I'm just going to show you this real quick. We've got an image here. I'll be posting this image, by the way, in the Guitar Interactive live stream hub after this stream. So if you want this image that you can keep, I'll post it in the live stream hub. So search Facebook for Guitar Interactive Livestream Hub, and you know, you'll find what we're doing here. So what we're looking at is we're looking at essentially three tiers of goals, and this is all to do it's all based on a body of research by, let me just get the guy's name, by Hockley et al, into behavior change and into setting and achieving goals successfully. And we have three tiers here. We have superordinate goals up at the top. In the middle, we have intermediate goals, and then we have subordinate goals. Now, I'm going to come back to that in just a second, right? So we'll come back to that image in a moment, but let's talk about what they are. So superordinate goals are top-level goals. These are things like, I want to have great chops, right? Now, if somebody said to you, give me a goal for 23, and you said, I want to make my chops fantastic. I want to have great chops. Well, you could get some pushback on that, in the sense that it's maybe not like, it's a little bit vague, and it's a bit more like, yeah, that's cool, man, but like, how are you planning on getting there? Because, you know, pretty vague. But ultimately, if that's what you want, that is what you want. And this all feeds into something that's at the very top of this chart, which is the ideal guitar playing self. So it's important to have these top level vision goals, I guess you want to call them, superordinate goals, they're referred to in the research. So this might be your vision of yourself. So the idealized version of you as a guitar player. I want you to take a moment and think about that, and think about, if I could wave a magic wand and make you the perfect version of you as a guitar player, what would that look like? Right? You don't have to tell me in the comments. You can if you'd like. I'd love to hear from you. I'd love to hear your story. But you know, an idealized version of yourself. So that might be a very skilled blues improviser who has great technique like Joe Bonamassa does, but is really inventive and creative and knows the all the notes on the fretboard and is able to play a whole bunch of blues standards, etc. Or it might be, you know, like a really fiery shredder with incredible technique and great vibrato and all that sort of stuff. That is the ideal vision of yourself. That is the dream version of you. And it's important to have that, because that essentially forms the why. It's the why we're doing this, right? And if you, all of your goals are little teeny tiny goals that are super achievable, that's cool, but you may lose the sense of like, well, why am I actually practicing? Why am I actually doing this? Because, you know, it's important to have that big top level vision. So from there, we can all expand out into multiple top level superordinate goals. So I have a few here. I have, because it's the latest course we've dropped, have great picking chops at the top and be a great improviser. Now, these are superordinate goals in the sense that, they're not immediately achievable. You can't sit down one day and develop great picking chops in a day. You know, Rome was not built in a day like that. But it is something that you can work towards with the next tier of goals. So what you might think about these as is, you might think about these top goals as being more like values. So they're a little more like, this is something that I value in a guitar player, and I value in myself, you know, my ability to have great vibrato or something like that, or be expressive and creative on the guitar. That's our top level goals. So it's important to have those, but from there, we can drill down into something like this next tier, which is our intermediate goals. Now, intermediate goals are more of a direction. And the important thing with this is intermediate goals have to have a clear path that gets you to your superordinate goal, your top level goal. So for example, we have a bunch down here. You can see all these like four goals that I've written out in the intermediate stage. We've got practice picking more often, learn more picking licks, explore different picking styles, watch/read more lessons from great pickers. Now, these are not like immediate achievable things. These are not things that you can go, okay, tomorrow I can practice picking more often. It's not how it works, but it is a path. It's how you're going to get there, right? So all of these goals, practicing picking more often, learning more picking licks, and exploring different picking styles, etc., they all feed into our top level goal of having great picking chops. And then down at the bottom, we have these actual achievable goals. These are the how, the when, the why, the what that you're going to do. These are our subordinate goals, and these are the things that you can achieve every day. So an example of this might be to practice picking exercise X. Let's say, for example, the Paul Gilbert exercise might be a good one. Let's go to the close-up cam. So I've actually used it at least once in this stream. So that might be this lick, for example, this. That lick that we've talked about so many times. It might be to practice that for 15 minutes every evening, or maybe 3 evenings a week. You want to practice it. The way you set these goals is kind of all down to your scheduling and down to you know, your preferences and all this sort of stuff, and what other goals you have to achieve too, because we'll talk about having multiple superordinate and top level goals as we go on. Another one of this is record a video of my technique every Sunday. So you notice this is time-based. These are little goals where I'm going, this is something I'm going to do on this day. It's a very specific thing I'm going to do. I'm going to record a video of my technique. And that feeds again into our practicing picking more often thing, because it means on Sundays we record videos of ourselves. Fill in a short entry in my practice diary every time I work on my picking. So that's another thing. These are little small actionable goals. So if you only have these small bottom level subordinate goals, we can get bored quite quickly and lose motivation. And you know, we kind of go, well, why am I even doing this? Like, what's this even for? But if you have just superordinate goals, if you just have big goals at the top, which are like, I want to have great picking chops, that's cool, but how are you going to get there? Do you know, what are you going to do day to day to make that happen? So this hierarchy of goals is a really cool and... Let's just go back to the stream. Hello, lost myself for a moment there. Took me out instead of that one. So it's very, very important to kind of have all of these steps here, but there's more to it than this, right? We're going to do an example of this together. We'll plot something for one of your goals, if that makes any sense, right? And we'll answer some questions later on too. So an example of this, so some examples of some of the cool things that go along with this anyway are, these are some big words, right? But this hierarchy of goals approach... your goals within this will have what is referred to in the research, at least, as, pardon me, equifinality and multifinality. Wow, big words. What the hell do they mean? Well, let's get into it. So this is really, really important for adherence, and it's super useful stuff, right? So equifinality is the idea that goals further up the hierarchy can be supported by multiple goals further down the hierarchy. Let's go back to a hierarchy and take a look at this, right? So let's say, for example, our goal of having great picking chops. Let's say practice picking more often, right? That's one of our goals. That supports our top level goal of having great picking chops. But so does learning more picking licks. And so does exploring more picking styles. And then within each of the bottom level goals within that, there are multiple ways to support those goals too. So what this means is... What this means is that you have multiple ways to win the day, so to speak. So if you just find yourself a little bit burned out on practicing this picking exercise, that's okay, because you have other ways you can service your goal of improving your picking technique. So for an example, what I might take the example of is, let's say I've been practicing that Paul Gilbert lick, and that was my thing. I'm dedicated to doing that 15 minutes, 3 days a week, and I'm just sitting down to go, I can't face that lick anymore. I'm done with that lick. That's okay, because I have other options, other ways that I can service my goal. I might go, well, let's learn some new picking licks. Let's maybe try something like this cool Aldi Meola lick, which might be something like this, where I might go... I'll show you that in the close-up cam so you guys can see what's going on there. Apologies if we're getting some noise. These pickups are a little noisy. So it might be something like this. That might be another lick that we could learn. And in learning that lick, we're servicing our goal further up the hierarchy, if that makes sense. So that's an example of our goals having equifinality. So what that means is multiple goals point to the same result. That's really important for motivational stuff, right? It keeps you focused. Now, another one that's interesting about this is multifinality. So our goals here will have something called multifinality, which is where one goal can support multiple goals further up the hierarchy. So let's take an example of this, right? Let's add stream. So if we take multiple goals further up the hierarchy, let's say we took the goal of learn more picking licks. That is in the middle, our middle rung there. So if you take a look at intermediate goal number two, learn more picking licks, that not only improves our picking chops, but it's also going to help us with that goal of being a great improviser, because we're improving our vocabulary as we go further forward. So that is servicing multiple goals. Now, that's interesting because that also gives you some more, some more motivational help, because what it means is if you're going, I can't really be bothered to learn any more picking licks. I just want to be better at my improvising. But, you know, if I learn some picking licks, that'll help me improvise better, and it's going to help me with my other goal of this, etc. And then going further down the rung, right, if we take this idea of like practice exercise X for 15 minutes every day, and you go, oh, I don't really want to do that today, I can't really be bothered, haven't really got time, and you go, yeah, but when I do that, like, my improvisations get better because I'm warmed up and I'm ready to go and I'm inspired with my progress, so I'm going to improvise better with that. So improvise better once I've done that. So that's an example of what we refer to as multifinality, which is where one goal further down the hierarchy supports multiple goals further up the hierarchy. Guys, if you're finding this useful and finding it interesting, let us know in the comments, because I think this stuff is absolutely fascinating. And what you'll notice at no point is that I haven't tried to make you quantify your goals and say, hey, let's make them time-based. Let's make them this, the other. It's a slightly different way of looking at things, but all the evidence seems to suggest that this is a very successful way of setting goals. So let's actually do some of that, right? Let's do some goal setting today. So what I want you guys to do is I want you in the comments, I'm going to play for a little bit, but I want you in the comments to drop me down a superordinate goal, and we're going to pick this one. So give me a superordinate top level goal. Let's just write a quick banner on here. Comment a top level goal. So guitar playing, so maybe not something like, you know, I want to have a 700 kilo powerlifting total or anything. So comment a top level guitar playing goal. I'm going to play a bit longer. I think I'm going to shift a different backing track. I'm going to go to our ambient ballad because it's a lot of fun. I'm going to play a little bit longer. I'll take just a few minutes while you comment your goals down below. So comment it's a top level goal. When we come back, we will structure out a hierarchy of goals for that top level goal, your top level goal of choice. Here we go. To that a little bit later on. So we've got some great comments coming in already. Let's see what we've got. So we've got some really, really good ones coming here. Marcin has a big one, right? Improvise with the melodic minor scale. That's cool, right? That is very, very cool. You guys find this useful as well, which I like. I'm into that, right? So I found this really useful too. That is very, very cool. Thank you so much for your comments, by the way. I really appreciate that. So improvise with melodic. Here's an interesting one. Improve guitar playing confidence. That's a big one that I quite feel feel like taking on, if I'm honest. I feel like having a go at that, because that's kind of a big guy. Better fretboard navigation for me and cleaner picking technique. That's also super interesting. But faster and cleaner, learn how to play without fluffing notes. Playing by ear. Oh, there's some good ones. There's some really, really good one. Practice my timing more. I think we're going to go with this one. Then we're going to go with improved guitar playing confidence. Right, so let's frame this in our superordinate, intermediate, subordinate goals approach, because I feel like this is a huge one that everybody could really, 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 really deal with, if that makes sense. I feel like everybody could benefit from being a slightly more confident guitar player. Unless you're one of these misplaced confidence guys, which I ask myself every day if that's me. Who knows? In every walk of life, not just playing the guitar. Apologies for drinking water on stream, but if you guys are been paying attention from the start, I'm really ill, and you can probably tell from the fact I keep scratching my nose, and I sound really, really bunged up. So let's do this, right? Let's do this real quick. So confidence in playing the guitar, let's make that our superordinate goal, right? So our top level goal is to be more confident playing the guitar. More confident playing the guitar. I want to know from you guys, with that in mind, right, more confident playing the guitar, what are some ways we could set some intermediate goals? Drop me the comments and let me know. Comment down below, right? What are ways that we can frame some intermediate goals for being more confident? Take a look at these ones here, right? So these are not things like, they're not immediate actions that we can do every day, but they're things that, they're like routes, they're pathways to get to our top level goal. So an example might be, here's one, right? If you want to feel more confident playing the guitar, keep removing myself from the stream instead of removing the image from the stream. So an example of an intermediate goal for feeling more confident would be to play in front of people more often. So play in front of people would be an example of an intermediate goal. And that would have its own set of subordinate goals down below. So let's take that, right? Let's take our intermediate goal of play in front of people. Challenge myself to play in front of people. Well, that's fine, but like, when are you going to do it? And exactly what are you going to do? So here's some ways you could do it. You could play in front of trusted members of your support circle. So don't go straight out to like, I'm just going to, you know, start doing IG lives all the time. But what you might do is you might film videos of yourself and you may send them to people you trust or send them to people who, you know, have got your back and go, hey, what do you think of this? Right. And, you know, get their feedback and take their feedback on board. If that makes sense. Here's another cool one, right? Four Corners says, join a cover band. It's an interesting one, right? It is an interesting one. Join a cover band. So that might be one, like, you know, that might be another goal. So like, you know, join a cover band. Kim's got a good one here. It says, film yourself playing, and that will help you realize that you may be better than you thought. That is a very good one, right? Very, very good one. So we're not coming to top level goals again. Let's just get rid of that. So our top level goal is feeling more confident. So an intermediate goal would be to play for people more. Right, play for people more, and there's loads of ways you could do that. Ways you could do that would be, I am going to play one gig every month, no matter how small it is. That could be going to an open mic night. I'm going to go to an open mic night the first Sunday of every month, and I'm going to play something, and I'm going to expose myself to doing this. Another intermediate goal. So we've talked about just actually doing the thing. Another intermediate goal would be to feel more qualified as a guitar player by improving your fretboard knowledge. Let's say knowing more about the instrument. So with knowledge and with mastery comes confidence. So knowing more about the guitar, let's say learning the fretboard better, that can be an intermediate goal. Like, improve my fretboard knowledge. So improved fretboard knowledge will make you feel more confident because you'll feel more qualified in what it is that you're doing. Now, ways you could then service that with subordinate goals would be to practice caged scale shapes for 15 minutes, 3 days a week, right? And you can see how that will service your intermediate goal, but also it's going to service your top level goal. And if you're having a day where you just don't feel confident and don't want to play in front of somebody, and you go, I don't want to play in front of people today, I've had a really bad day at work, things just aren't going my way today, you can go, that's cool, we'll just shift to another goal that can service the same result, right? This is where our equifinality comes in. We'll switch to our next. You say, I don't want to play in front of people. Hey, that's cool. I don't want to go to the open mic night. Don't worry about it. You can sit and practice some scales and work on that too. Or you can video yourself and fire that across. Another way that you may work on feeling more confident as a guitar player is we've got knowledge. That's one of them. We've got kind of support structure. Another way you might do it is jamming with other players. So jamming with other guitar players, I am going to jam with other guitar players more. So what that might involve is finding a guitar playing friend and going, I'm going to go for coffee and jam with a guitar playing friend on my level. I'm not going to find some master who's just going to paste me every time I sit down and play with him. I'm going to find a guitar playing friend who's kind of on my level, and we're going to jam the blues once a month or once a fortnight. We're going to go for coffee, talk about guitars. We'll go and look at some guitars and shops, and then we'll go and do that. So that's an example of how we might structure a hierarchy of goals for feeling more confident as a guitar player. Now, you feel free to fill this out however you want. I would encourage you to actually do this on a piece of paper. But what's cool about this is we have the ideal version of self, which is a confident guitar player. And then we have ways of kind of routes to get there with our intermediate goals, and then we have actionable steps on those routes. So you might think about it as like destination, the pathway, and then the steps that you take on those paths. And each one of these has both equifinality and multifinality. And again, I'm going to just reiterate those. Equifinality is where a goal further up the hierarchy can be supported by multiple goals, which means if you don't feel like doing one of your goals on a given day, it's just not working for you, you can achieve another small goal and still service the same higher goal. And they also exhibit multifinality in that one goal can support multiple goals further up the stream. So that's an example of how you might do that as becoming a more confident guitar player, if that makes sense. So yeah, anyway, that is the way I would do that. What I'm going to encourage you guys to do is I'm going to encourage you to do this. Oh, here's another really great one. Cowcat says, teach a non-guitar player. That is very good. Keith MOF says, play along to backing tracks. Learn a few riffs as fallback scenarios. That's great, actually. Learn a few break glass riffs is a good one. So I have a break glass shred lick. That makes any sense, right? So if it's time to shred, I'm like, help. Sometimes the shred is not there. So the break glass shred, like for me, is this four note string thing where, ooh, I can't do it now. That's an example of the break glass lick where I'm like, I don't know what to play. I'm going to play that. But learning a few of those, learning a few break glass and, you know, like blues licks, for example, like, that's a really, really good one, right? So it's a very good suggestion from Rob K. I really like that. Some fallback scenarios are killer. So I'm going to encourage you guys to do this yourselves. If you want to take a look at some other ideas, for example, I want to show you just very quickly a couple more of the courses that we have available for you as part of your GI Plus membership, in case you forgot. There are two we're going to take a look at right now, and when we come back, we'll be answering your questions. I'm going to go a little bit longer on this because I want to show you both of these courses. When we come back from these quick, brief looks at these courses, I'm going to show you, we're going to be answering your questions. So drop your questions down below. In the meantime, this is Mastering Modes Part 1 and also Expressive Techniques Part 1. You might be thinking, why are they both called Part 1? It's because Part 2 is coming this year. So we've done Part 1, Part 2 is coming. In the meantime, check these out. We're going to start with Mastering Modes. I'll show you Expressive Techniques when we come back. It's time for your questions. Modes. What are modes? How do I use them? When do I use them? Well, modes are one of the things that the pros use to add excitement and color to the guitar parts, and there is no reason why you can't use them too.
Now, for some reason, people, especially certain online guitar teachers, love to make modes seem complicated and scary, but I'm here to tell you they really, really aren't. And in fact, if you know the pentatonic scale, I can show you how to play modes with just two extra notes. In this course, I'll show you how to play careless sounding guitar solos using modes without any of the mystery. You'll learn how to play musical sounding solos all across the neck in any key, crucially without sounding like you're just running up and down scales. So, if you're ready to take this next step with me, click the link to find out more. Hi guys, Nick Jennison with Guitar Interactive and GI Plus. Does your playing sound like this? When really you'd like it to sound like this? Now, the difference between these two examples are not the notes that are being played, but rather the way the notes are being played. I'm sure you've heard this before. Guitar players will say to you, it's not what you play, it's how you play it. And when it comes to creating interesting, emotive, and musical sounding guitar lines, that is very much the case. And in this course, Expressive Techniques Part 1, we aim to equip you with the tools to sound more musical, more emotive, more interesting, and ultimately more expressive on the guitar. And we are going to do this by exploring the three principal left-hand expressive techniques, which are slides, bends, and vibrato. I'm going to show you the mechanics of these techniques and how you can execute them cleanly, efficiently, and reliably. I'll also give you some exercises to help develop these techniques. And we're also going to discuss some musical applications, how you might use these techniques in your own playing. We're going to go into great depth with that stuff. And I'm also going to give you a solo study, a piece of music I've prepared. And I'm going to encourage you and kind of guide you through the process of applying expression to an otherwise expressionless and bare sounding piece of guitar playing. So at the end of this course, you are going to be able to take otherwise uninteresting and fairly dry pieces of music and turn them into expressive, colorful, musical lines. And you're also going to be able to take this and apply it to your own playing or to other people's music that maybe you're playing and you want to express in your own way. This is Expressive Techniques Part 1. My name is Nick Jennison for Guitar Interactive GI Plus. I hope you'll join me. I will see you in there.
I could sneak a cough in, but I couldn't. So there you go, guys. That's a look at two of the courses that you might use to reach your guitar playing goals for 2023. Of course, the place to get them is GI Plus. Right up here, that's the exclusive lesson platform from Guitar Interactive magazine. Links are down below. You can get all of my lessons there, including and also lessons from Andy Wood, Andy James, Tom Quayle, Ian Simo, Michelangelo Batio is in there. Who knew? Bizarre. But you want some shred? Hey, that's there. Who else do we have? Manelli Jamal, Sam Bell, Rick Graham, loads of great guitar players, but we're going to turn our attention to your questions. So if you have questions, I will try my best to get some answers for you. So let's take a look at some of these first of all. A really, really nice comment here, by the way, from Cole Bertram says, I absolutely adore your guitar tones and playing. Oh man, thank you so much. I really appreciate that. Aside from super cracking and pickups, what else do you do to help achieve these tones? A couple of cool things I think you might play with. So I always, I'm running through Boss Wah's Tube Amp Expander here. I always have a little bit of room mic blended in. That's not a mic in the room that I'm in. It's a virtual room microphone that I always have blended into my tone. I'm just going to show you what's going on here. So if you give me a quick second, I'm going to pull up the Wah's Tube Amp Expander editor. If you're using modelers, this seems to be the thing. A little bit of ambience seems to go a very long way. So I'll turn my delay off, because I have lots of delay on too. But here's an example of the tone with the room mic on. I'm now going to turn the room mic off. Back on. It's quite subtle, but it just adds a sense of realism to what's going on here. I'm using a combination of Celestion and Owen Hammer impulse responses. This is the Owen Hammer, what's it called now? GNR cab. So it's the cab from User Illusion, not User Illusion, Chinese Democracy, apparently. Most expensive guitar cab ever recorded or whatever. There's some hype around it, but it's a great sounding IR. Using some greenbacks in that one. So good IRs really help. Another thing with this, I guess, is touch as much as anything else. So you are the person and you are the thing creating the tone. So we've talked a lot about in previous streams about how you might use your right hand touch and your left hand touch to create a pleasant sounding tone. But I think the room mic is kind of a fun thing that you can act on, like right now, if you're using using IRs, let's say, or you're going direct. A little bit of room ambience makes makes all the difference, I think. Great question, though, man. Thank you so much. I appreciate that. We got another one here. Don Goller, great comment, says, what you're saying, Nick, makes real sense. Great advice. Been playing for more years than I can remember. In and out of bands. Highs and lows of confidence. Totally agree with everything you've said. Hey, thanks, man. I really appreciate it. I felt like that was a really important question to tackle. I guess a little thing with that as well, with regards to confidence, is to be aware of the state of the guitar playing landscape with regards to social media and with regards to the guitar playing that we see on our phones and on our computers all day, every day. A lot of times it's kind of manicured to the point of, I don't want to throw anybody under the bus, but it's manicured to the point of being deceptive. I would say, and that's fine, because people can post whatever they want. If somebody wants to post a video that is framed as a performance when in reality it's maybe not so, maybe it's been, you know, pre-recorded and mimed along to, or notes have been touched up or any of that stuff, it's okay, but it can create a sense of perfectionism in your playing that is both unwarranted and harmful. So what you'll notice is when I go and play stuff, I'm not saying that nobody ever makes mistakes, right? An example of a guitar player who is flawless just so much of the time is someone like Tom Quayle, right? Tom's legit, but there are guitar players out there who present themselves as more flawless than they actually are. For me, I want to show you the flaws. I want to show you what a guitar player actually sounds like. So you'll always hear me make little scuffs and little gaffes, and sometimes I'll do intro jams at the start of streams that just go horribly wrong, and we'll leave them in because that's what we do. I feel like having a sense of reality and a sense that you are a human being and you will never play to a machine-like level of perfection, nor should you necessarily aspire to, can be very helpful. That realization for me was big, where I'm like, look, don't feel like you have to be internet perfect. Work towards it, but cut yourself some slack if you start making some mistakes. I got in a bit of a rant there. But if any of you have watched any crazy shred jams recently where there are some impossible guitar playing going on, going, oh, how can a person do that? you know. Anyway, let's get out of that. So Sacred Godslayer has a great question. It says, not related to the stream at all, but I found that I have hard times improvising ideas and backing tracks with little movement in the chord progression. Think the Pantera backing track on GI+. Now, that is very interesting in and of itself because I'm kind of with you. Sometimes you can go one of two ways. You can kind of go a couple of ways with this. You can either have not enough information on the backing track to inspire you to actually do stuff, but you know, you maybe need some more harmonic input to give you some ideas to play some stuff. Or you may find the harmonic input is too much, you know, straitjacketed by the chords. That's how Miles Davis came to do Kind of Blue, because he was like, I don't feel like I need, you know, I feel like I'm straitjacketed by these chords in hard bop. I just want two chords now. We're playing So What, and it's going to be... These are the chords now. There is one chord. Miles, you can't just have one chord. All right, we'll have two, but it's the same thing up a semitone, and it's only in the bridge. The thing with this is, a way I like to think about this stuff is I like to imagine trying to imply chord changes that aren't there. If you feel like you want more harmonic information, think about the one that you want, the harmonic information you might like, and just play as if it were there. So let's take an example of something like the I don't have the Pantera one handy. It's a great track. I did enjoy putting that one together. But I might take an example of something like the here's probably a good one. This is the Led Zeppelin style one we did, the Hindenburg Jam. Let's find it, because it's just two chords, right? So I'm going to play for this real quick, and I'm going to imply some harmony that's not there. So it's just the same thing over and over again. It's not going to be a tiny bit. So what I might do is I might start with the good old-fashioned E minor stuff, like pentatonic-y things. When I'm a little bored of that, what I might start doing is I might start trying to imply chord changes that aren't there. So I might try and apply this chord change in my improvising. So I might try and play something like this. So that's an example of implying that. Or what I might do is I have a few progressions, not progressions, in chord progressions, a few movements I like to do that go progressively more wrong. So what I may do, I'm just going to backtrack this real quick so I've got enough time to do it. I have this fun progression I like to do where I like to go from melodic minor, sorry, from, let's mute the backtrack while we do this. We're going from pentatonic to Dorian to melodic minor to whole tone, because it sounds progressively more nasty as we go, but you can always regress each of those steps. So it's pentatonic to Dorian to melodic minor to whole tone. And the whole tone in question in this case would be, it would be the whole tone that's a semitone down from the root note, because it contains those melodic minor notes. So it might sound like this. Let's just have a go. Why not? So pentatonic. So that sort of thing can be quite fun. But I mean, another thing with this is playing over a single chord for a long time can give you, it can be a challenge. It can be a challenge to actually develop ideas. So that can be quite good fun. A fun thing to play with. Maybe we'll do a whole stream on that at some point, because that's a very, very good question. Rob K says, which GI lessons do you advise to learn the improvisation stuff? Really good question. So Tom Quayle has some fabulous ones on. Let's actually just get the GI page up real quick. I'm going to find it. And I may share my screen with you guys. Let's see. GI Plus, let's maybe go over some together. Oh, by the way, if you're in the Guitar Interactive Livestream Hub, I have posted the image, that's the one, the image and the link to the podcast I'm talking about in there. So if you're on Facebook, search Facebook for Guitar Interactive Livestream Hub. So let's just go digging real quick. So lesson series, I'm actually just going to get the page up very, very quickly. I'll show you what's going on here. Or I'll try to. My screen is not wanting to share terribly quickly. So, okay, is it present? Share screen. Cool, right, let's share this screen. So here we have look at the GI Plus lessons page. So there's a lot of pictures of me going on here, which I'm just aware of. I don't know how they've all ended up on the top, but things for improvising. So I really like expressive techniques, which is this guy right here. I like mastering modes a lot. That's another very, very cool one for improvising. And the ultimate guide to melody and phrasing. Those are three courses from me that are good for the improv thing, but they're not the only ones, right? So what you may go looking at, there are some real good ones down here from Tom. Let's just go and search for those. So things like Coltrane Changes is a very good one. Oh, you know what? It's this one. It's Modern Guitar. Modern Guitar from Tom Quayle. There is so much great improvisation stuff in there. That is huge. Certainly if you're improvising over changes, but Coltrane Changes down here is another very good one. That is a very underrated course, Coltrane Changes. That is very specifically improvising over the Coltrane Changes. And right next to it is a course from Cameron Allen. This is another sleeper course with some great stuff on how you can take blues and you can start to incorporate jazz elements into it. Above it, Danny Gill's got another good one. Danny Gill's great. I keep forgetting to mention Danny Gill's in there. Here's another one, Soloing Over Chord Changes by Tom Quayle. That's a great one for learning to improvise over changes, as is Creating Tension. We've got so many great Tom lessons here, it's not even funny. Let's do some more. Sam Bell has a whole course called Rock Improvisation that you may look at if, pardon me. Did I mention I'm ill? Here's the one on there. Rock Improvisation. That's another really great one. There's some really killer stuff in Michael Caswell's Pro Concept, but that's just, it's a very deep and very broad series of lessons. Maybe not super improvisation focused. Let's maybe go one more. Ian Semo's Slide Guitar for Standard Tuning is a real good one. Right, a real good one here. Now, it is slide guitar focused, but that doesn't mean it's just slide guitar, right? It doesn't mean it's only slide guitar. There is way more stuff in there than just that. So that's a look at the lesson page, right? There's loads of them. We've got more stuff coming too. So keep your eyes peeled. New lessons dropping all the time. But those are the places I'd recommend starting. If you need to, just watch that back on the replay or rewind the stream, take some notes on that. That was quite good fun. I'm going to do that more often. I think I'll just show you guys what's going on in there. So listen, guys, we are running clean out of time. We've run way, way, way over, as we always do. But I want to thank you so much for taking this opportunity. Sorry, for giving me this opportunity to come and talk to you guys about practice, about some stuff that's not necessarily artist-related, but I think is really useful. I'm going to encourage you to watch this stream again on the replay. It'll be available on our YouTube channel. While you're there, give us a subscribe if you're not already. Hit the notification bell so we can let you know when we're about to go live, because I don't want you to miss this stuff. But this was quite a deep stream. There was lots of things to consider there. If you want access to that infographic yourself, you can find it in the Guitar Interactive Livestream Hub, which is our Facebook group. Just search Guitar Interactive Livestream Hub, and there it is. I'm going to encourage you to write your own structures. I'm looking forward to hearing what you guys come up with next week. In the meantime, I'm just going to jam out a little bit more on that. I'm really feeling the Richie Kotzen style backing track from the start. I'm really digging that one today. I don't know why. It's just one of my go-tos. I think that funk rock thing, I think I played so much of it in my youth that it's kind of really hard for me to get away from. So I'm going to play that a little bit more. I think if I can locate it, where has it gone? Here it is. I've got so many backing tracks in a big Logic project just right down here that I'm throwing on there. But yes, I'm going to play a wee bit. And yeah, hey man, thank you so much for joining me. Really appreciate it. Happy New Year. All the best to you for 2023. Looking forward to doing some really cool stuff together. In the meantime, I'm going to play things out. If you want more lessons, GI Plus URL is down below. You guys know where to go. And we'll be back next Monday, 8 p.m. UK time. Says so down here with another live stream. You guys know how it all works by now. I will see you next week. Take care of yourselves. Bye for now. play more of this on my own time. In the meantime, guys, thank you so much for having us. My name's Nick Jennison for Guitar Interactive and GI Plus. This is a little sneak peek at some of the other stuff you get in your GI Plus membership. I'll see you guys next week.
My name's Nick Jennison, and it's a pleasure to introduce to you GI Plus, the brand new lesson platform brought to you by Guitar Interactive. We've assembled a team of the best players and educators in the world to bring you exclusive lessons covering everything from metal to blues to fusion and everything in between. Want to level up your shred chops? Check out How to Play Fast by Andy James. Or how about Sweet Picking with Rick Graham? Or maybe country's more your bag. Well, how about a full-length exclusive country guitar course from Andy Wood? Interested in learning how to play over changes? Well, members get access to hours of exclusive lessons from fusion maestro Tom Quayle. Or maybe you want your playing to sound more soulful? Well, who better than Chris Buck to show you how it's done? Or perhaps you want to learn the secrets of the masters. Well, members get access to over 60 feature-length tech sessions where our tutors painstakingly decode the styles of players like David Gilmour, Eddie Van Halen, John Petrucci, Larry Carlton, Slash, Tosin Abassi, Paul Gilbert, and many more. You get all this along with exclusive live webinars, free backing tracks, competitions, and so much more. So what are you waiting for? Sign up for GI Plus today.